From what the planet itself is to whether it becomes a place we live on in the future, join us as we explore the finding of TOI 700D. So let's jump right in, shall we? NASA's Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite, TESS, has discovered its first Earth-sized planet in its star habitable zone, the range of distances where conditions may be just right to allow the presence of liquid water on the surface. Scientists confirmed the find called TOI 700D using NASA's Spitzer Space Telescope and have modeled the planet's potential environments to help inform future observations. I know I just unloaded a massive amount of information on you, so let's just break it down step by step. The TESS is a satellite that is also a massive telescope. Its job is to find planets that could be life-filled, but also ones of a certain size. You know what? Here's the NASA description of it. The Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite, TESS, is a NASA-sponsored astrophysics Explorer-class mission that is performing an all-sky survey to search for planets transiting nearby stars. The primary goal of TESS is to discover planets smaller than Neptune that transit stars bright enough to enable follow-up spectroscopic observations that can provide planet masses and atmospheric compositions. So yeah, the TESS is supposed to find planets that we can study and hopefully determine whether they are able to support life, or more importantly, support us. The discovery of TOI 700D is very important because it's literally the first planet it has found, and trust me, there are plenty of planets it's found so far, that fits the needs of life itself. Or at least it's the most like Earth in the grand sense of things. So you can imagine why a lot of scientists are interested in learning more and more about this planet as a whole. Now, if you don't recall what habitable zone means, it's about distance from the Sun, or more specifically, the orbital region around a star in which an Earth-like planet can possess liquid water on its surface and possibly support life. Think about it in terms of our own solar system. The Earth is within the habitable zone of our Sun, thus we're able to live, have water, have an atmosphere that allows us to be hot and cold without being on either extreme, and so on and so forth. But if you look at Venus, because of its proximity to the Sun, it's a lot hotter, and thus it suffers from the greenhouse effect, where gases fill up its atmosphere to such a degree that it's really hot on the surface, so hot that it melts metals. Meanwhile, on Mars, it's so far away from the Sun that it's usually really cold. So cold that no life can survive, that we know of. And the water that is there is frozen in ice at the polar caps. That habitable zone is what we define as the must-be-there zone in terms of planets we'd like to try and colonize, or even just expect life to be on. Because if it's not in that zone, it usually is an ice world, a storm world, a gas planet, or something in between. Heck, there are even planets within the habitable zone of a star that don't always meet the requirements of life, but we still look in that zone because it's the best chance of finding things there. And since TOI 700D is in that zone and is Earth-sized, it might just be something special. Emphasis on might, because as you all have hopefully learned over the course of your lives, you can't judge a book by its cover. And in this case, you can't judge a planet because it looks like it might be an Earth-like planet, or might be the same size as Earth. Because in the planet-finding race, it's not just the planet you need to worry about, it's the Sun, too. After all, our yellow dwarf star is a big reason why we exist right now. It's the right type of star to support life as a whole. It gives us the right amount of sunlight, heat, and tether in regards to our orbit to allow us to live. For TOI 700D, it doesn't technically have that. It is in the habitable zone, but there are a few things different from its star than ours. Before we dive into more of this topic, be sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel. That way you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Primary among the differences of these stars is that the star near TOI 700D is a red dwarf star, which if you don't know is the smallest star type in the Milky Way galaxy. But in a twist, it's also the one that is the most popular in terms of numbers in the galaxy. So why don't we see more of them? Because they're the type of star to not emit so much light that you can see them across the galaxy. So if you look up at the night sky, you're not going to see any red dwarf stars. But there's a catch in that. While they don't emit as much light or heat as our own sun, they're the most stable kind of star in our galaxy, meaning that radiation bursts, solar flares, and more don't happen on the star. So if a planet is near one of these stars, like TOI 700D, that would mean it wouldn't be in danger of having a dangerous flare event happening and burning up the atmosphere or bombarding it with radiation, both of which could be world-ending events. In 11 months of data, we saw no flares from the star, which proves the chances of TOI 700D is habitable and makes it easier to model its atmospheric and surface conditions, says Emily Gilbert, a graduate student at the University of Chicago. So yeah, that is something in favor of the planet, but there are more catches here, not the least of which is that, based on what we've seen on the planet, it's one that is tidally locked with its sun. To be tidally locked means that the planet is only facing the sun halfway. It never rotates itself in a way that helps it turn away from the sun. So thus, there is a literal line down the planet. One side always faces the sun, and one side doesn't. Usually, this would mean that the temperatures on the planet are extremely hot on one side and extremely cold on the other. But because this is a red dwarf star, that may not be the case. Not enough heat and light are produced from it and reach the habitable zone to make that kind of thing happen, that we know of. In fact, when NASA first discovered TOI 700D, they brought in an expert on the subject of simulations and whether planets and their climates would be habitable for humans. The person worked with NASA, and this is what they determined. The climate simulations our NASA team has completed suggest that an Earth-like atmosphere and gas pressure isn't adequate to support liquid water on its surface. If we put the same quantity of greenhouse gases as we have on Earth on TOI 700D, the surface temperature on this planet would still be below freezing. Now, that may sound like a death sentence for the planet, but it's not in this area anyway. Because while a planet may be below freezing in terms of temperature, that's not uninhabitable. Plus, these are just simulations. They technically can't prove anything other than the expectations based on our knowledge of worlds and how they form. The bigger nail in the coffin of this particular planet is the distance, as it's 100 light years away from us, but that's a topic for a later time. The point here is that whether we like it or not, this planet may seem like Earth in some ways, but it's missing key points that make it a perfect Earth replica. No matter what we find out about the planet, it's going to look completely different from what we have here on Earth, says Gabrielle Engelman-Suisa. Just how much different? Well, how about two examples of what this planet may just be? An ocean-covered planet, a dense carbon dioxide-dominated atmosphere, much like a young Mars, with a deep layer of clouds on the star-facing side. A cloudless all-land version of modern Earth. Winds flow away from the night side of the planet and converge on the point directly facing the star. Not intolerable, but not exactly what we'd like to live on, am I right? Naturally, this discovery was a big deal, and since it was a potentially groundbreaking planet discovery, the team wanted to make sure that they had the science and math to prove that this was what they said it was. Given the impact of this discovery, that it is TESS's first habitable zone Earth-sized planet, we really wanted our understanding of this system to be as concrete as possible, says Rodriguez. Spitzer saw TOI 700D transit exactly when we expected it to. It's a great addition to the legacy of a mission that helped confirm two of the TRAPPIST-1 planets and identify five more. So even with the somewhat downfalls that could lead us away from TOI 700D, this is still a big discovery for TESS and the team working on it with NASA and others. In fact, it proves all the more that things like TESS are necessary, because there are potential Earth-like planets that are out there, even if a majority of them have faults that lead them to being somewhat much different than our Earth. That just means we need to look harder at what's out there, and through things like TESS, we have that option. You might be asking right now, wait a minute, if the one we're looking at is D, doesn't mean that there are A to C that could work too? Technically, yes, but those planets aren't in the habitable zone of the star, and thus are unlivable in a variety of ways. Again, timing and placement is everything. Which brings us to, okay, so this planet is a bust. Is there any other planets out there that could be Earth-like? And the answer to that is also yes. We have found planets that could be a place for us to live on, But like always, there are catches. For example, the planet that everyone thinks is the next Earth to live on is a planet called Alpha Centauri, a planet that has characteristics close to Earth and could be a place we live on one day. Keyword here is one day. That's because right now, Alpha Centauri is 4.2 light years away. While that may sound small, if we were to try and reach it in our fastest craft's speed, we'd get there in about a couple tens of thousands of years, if we're lucky. That's not quick at all. So much so that you might be questioning why we would even want to try and find planets like TOI 700D, which again is 100 light years away and thus much farther away than Alpha Centauri, if there is no chance of reaching them. The answer to that is simple. Yeah, we might not reach them right now, but there is hope to reach them one day. Think about it in terms of Star Trek, which is very much based on Earth, just a future Earth. By their own admission, the fact that Starfleet existed at all was because of great advances in technology that happened for them over the course of time, which is exactly where we are right now. If you told someone in the year 1920 that we would be able to fly all over the world with ease in giant metal planes that weighed many tons, they'd laugh at you. If you told them that one day they'd be able to put computers in the palm of their hands and be able to look up all sorts of information, they wouldn't even know what a computer is. 100 years can make a lot of difference in people's lives, especially when it comes to technology. Even right now, there are scientists who are working hard and try to make the next generation engage a starship, including making engines that could allow us to go at least close to the speed of light, if not faster. There's even a project right now called Longshot. Yes, the name is ironic. That is aiming to use an advanced kind of technology to take a craft to Alpha Centauri in only a couple of years' time versus tens of thousands. So clearly we've got top men on this. Thus why TESS and other satellites, probes, and more are needed. After all, if we get the way to get there, we need to know where to go, especially if we need to do research on whether it's habitable at all. We're very much on the outside looking in, but if we can get closer, yeah, the sky is the limit here. TOI 700D may or may not be what we're looking for in terms of a planet that we can live on, but it's close. It may not be close enough, but it's close. It's an Earth-sized planet in the habitable zone of a star. And if there is one like that, there could be one that's even closer to what we need to live on another Earth. And that is enough hope to get many people to look for more planets among the stars. Thanks for watching, everyone. What did you think of this look at TOI 700D and whether it might just be the next planet that has life on it? Do you think that it'll be everything that we hope for and more? Or do you think that there is something lurking within it that'll deter us from trying to get there one day? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe and I'll see you next time on the channel.